So first is, it's a great pleasure to be here. It's very exhilarating to watch the energy that a startup brings, and we've been associated with startups for the longest time. Most of us who couldn't do some of these things did the next best thing that was possible. So 5 years back, many of us joined what we call as a 70-year-old startup bank and decided to change the way one approaches banking, if we may. So we did bring a little bit of a change in the way in which we approached service to customers as well. When this entire transformation journey was happening, we were very clear that we can't build everything ourselves. There is only up to a point that we will be able to reach, and so we decided to take a very differentiated approach to the way in which we will deal with our partners, our customers, and startups, and so on. And the journey so far has been very, very exciting at RBL Bank. No day is the same. It's just like all your lives. No day is the same for us. Every day is a challenge because we are facing new issues. We are trying to solve new problems with all of you ourselves. So we get engaged with our startup partners with equal energy and verve, and try to solve the problems with them. So we call ourselves a solution-oriented bank. And we've actually developed this entire property called India Startup Club. You would have seen some of those write-ups outside. What we do in this particular structure is that we make sure that we are connecting to startups at a partnership level. We even go beyond our call of banking. We generally work with areas such as legal, HR. These are things that flummox startups. So we have an entire structure in which we work with partners, with startups in a way in which we groom them. And we have nurtured some very successful startups such as Happy. I mean, you would have heard of them. They are a good expense management company. There's a company called Transurve who has worked with us for 5 years. These are people who we have nurtured and grown along with us, and we have enjoy a very beautiful relationship with them. So one of the things that is remarkable about the environment in which you all live is the fact that the business environment is very conducive for startups. We heard a lot of conversations from the minister and the BJP spokesperson. The conducive environment is, when I was thinking about what I'm going to speak to you about, I thought I should break my conversations into two parts. One is I wanted to talk about the environment and what it has to offer for fintech companies and so on. And also at the end talk about what I think made the difference at RBL Bank, what it is that we did for 5 years that helped us grow, that still helps us grow at a CAGR rate of 44%. We moved our balance sheet to a 56,000 crore balance sheet. What did we do? What I thought as an inside view, supporting my MD, Mr. Vishwai Rahuja, what I thought really made the difference, I wanted to share with you. So among some of the things happening today, I think is the digital push by the government, right? Cashless, less cash, whatever that it may be. There are still, naysayers who say that it's perhaps possible that people will fall back to cash. You know, the digital push that they did is short-lived. Is that really going to happen? But I, for one, believe that there is a strong chance that we will move the needle slightly. I don't think it's feasible to become a cashless economy. Perhaps it doesn't even make sense to become a cashless economy. But for sure, I'm sure the needle will shift a little bit. Some of the things that's happening in terms of UPI, the Bheem app that came out, all of that is, I've seen excitement with people when they look at UPI and realize that they really don't need to do much to send and receive money now. Okay. The fact is, Paytm did play a role in making merchant payments easier. So the entire ecosystem is moving in a way in which cashless is possible. Because of cashless coming into picture, what is really happening is we are becoming a data-rich economy. We as bankers have started realizing the value what we see as a trend that is likely to happen. One of the other innovations that's happening in our country is the entire proliferation of Aadhaar. I don't know how many of you feel have felt the touch of Aadhaar, but I can vouch for the fact that in many parts of rural India, in many parts of areas where banking has possibly not reached, Aadhaar actually plays a very important role. So, I think one of the clear differentiations that has happened in the last 3 years is what we call as the Jam Trinity and the India Stack. I don't know how many of you have heard about it, but it is an extremely powerful tool, right? When we talk about Jam, what we mean is that the Jandan Yojana that the government did actually got in huge number of accounts into the fold, okay? The second thing that they did was to enable Aadhaar. So today, if you really look at what India Stack does for us, and we as financial services providers really look excitedly at this, is that it has made presenceless identification possible. Today, many of us do onboarding of customers using eKYC, which is purely Aadhaar-based. The regulatory framework has changed enough to say that you can, onboard small accounts with just an OTP and not have to do biometric. So the presenceless layer has got created. We are able to today do paperless account opening because it's possible to load documents into e-docs. You have e-signature layer available. So today we are able to manage an entirely paperless process because of the paperless structure created through the Aadhaar structure. The cashless layer that's getting created, which was heavily used during our demonetization phase. We had a challenge very recently when we were trying to do loan disbursements. We figured out that we just didn't have enough cash to give our loan disbursements. It was absolutely a shot from the dark when we realized using the Aadhaar number, we could transfer money to a person's bank account and they could then utilize it in their own environment wherever it was feasible. So that's how cashless is getting enabled through the various properties that have been created through the India Stack, where NPCI is playing a big role. This is using UPI, using IMPS, using Aadhaar-enabled payments, etc. And the best thing that's yet to be absorbed in the industry is the consent architecture getting created using Aadhaar. So as people who work in the financial services industry, we believe that this is going to be the game changer, where perhaps Aadhaar will become everything in a person's financial life, right? Of course, cashless, less cash is slowly hitting us. When we start pre-demonetization, we were at a 2% digital expenses, we are at a 2% digital coverage level, okay? Industry, if you look at the best industry, if you look at Sweden, they are at 65%, and that's the catch-up we need to do. There are enablers. What has to happen is a cultural change. A lot remains to be seen if we are able to keep the traction going, but we know for a fact that we had 300% to 400% growth as part of the demonetization strategy. The other thing that we believe is making a change in the industry today is small is big. All along, what most banks like us used to do is go for large value, low volume transactions, make our money. The creamy layer was important. That's how we were looking at business, right? Today, the business model has changed. We, for instance, believe that the banking is reaching the telecom mobile recharge structure, right? So we believe that pocket-sized payments, large volume, small revenue transactions is the way to go. And we, for instance, have seen that grow phenomenally. Like, for instance, we started out 2 years back at a IMPS volume of about 5 crores or so per month. Today, we process 300 crores of IMPS volumes, and these are all small value transactions. Remittance happens at 2,500 rupees to 3,000 rupees, and this is real and is happening, right? So we recognize the fact that small is going to be big. Micro loans, micro lending, micro insurance, all of this is happening. And I think the actual fact is the PM Jandan Yojana and the PM Jeevan Suraksha Yojana, which was launched, really showed the way on how this micro segment can be tapped very well. Today I see private players also playing the micro-insurance play, right? The other aspect of this whole thing is platform banking, right? So we have set ourselves a target of creating a platform banking. And what does platform banking mean? Most of you would have realized that whenever there is a situation where somebody does an internet commerce versus a platform commerce, the platform commerce guys have grown faster. Just to take an example, if you look at a case like take a JW Marriott posting his own net site versus looking at an Airbnb. Airbnb has grown at multiplicity of volumes. We believe that the banking industry is structured for that right now. So we have, as a bank, launched a platform banking strategy. And what do? We have created an open API banking structure. We have launched APIs in which you can open accounts if you want to. You can create loans if you want to. You can query on our system for interest rates using APIs if you want to. So we believe that when producers and consumers work off our platform, we would be fine to do that. So this is very different from what other banks do. We are the lead players. Now there are a lot of other people who are getting into it. But we singularly believe that we don't necessarily need to own the account. As long as we are enabling transactions on our platform, we are fine to go with it, because at the end of it, what you have to do is a service role in the payment ecosystem and not necessarily play the manufacturing role in the ecosystem. The next big thing that's happening is data poor to data rich and data insight to data information to data insight. And we have started, and I believe that again the industry is at a trajectory where using the consent layer, using the BBPS information, using the GSTN information, we're going to be having a burst of information that's available. How do we use it to provide services to our consumers in the best possible manner? That's what is the next big trend in the industry. As a bank, we are also following this very closely, and we are working towards enabling it for our partners as well. So, and one of the key things that people have spoken about this before, but I have seen that the innovation is happening because of creation of micro experiences. So take any small experience, solve it the right way, and you're actually creating innovation, and that's what Celia was talking about, and the problem need not be very big. The other thing that I noticed, so we work very closely with startups, and we know that there are a lot of startup failures that happen. And one of the things that I have learned and I thought I should share with you is that most startups get very hung up about the solution rather than the problem. Once they have decided that this is the solution, they get very hung up and keep trying the same thing again and again. And sometimes you have to see that there is a dead end. You can restart again, look at the problem again and solve it, because the problem is for real. So if you guys focus on the problem and do not focus on the solution that you have thought, and sometimes it's very natural, right? The solution that you have developed, you feel it's your own baby. You really don't want to give up on it, right? But I think there is a time when you should start thinking, no, this is fine. The solution is not working. And I have seen both kind of startups work with us. People who have got hung up and hence gone downwards, and people who have reinvented themselves and taken a completely different path and become successful because they've still solved the problem and not looked at the solution that they had originally thought about. So this is what I have been seeing as trends in the industry. Very quickly, wanted to talk about what we pursued as a culture in the organization when we joined. One thing was very clear for us. We had to have a relentless pursuit for excellence. Excellence in whatever we did was a mandate that came as for the group of us. So there was never, we all love to say that we are a jugadu organization, a country. Hum jugad se kuch kar sakte hain. But I think there are no shortcuts. At the end of it, you have to do a good job for people to believe in you. And we as a organization followed it, and it came top down. Yeah. Complacence was a bad word, and I experienced it in a really big way when I was doing my first implementation in the bank, right? So I joined the tech group, and I was supposed to implement the first big core banking transformation for the bank. And it was a 10-month, 24/7 work, and we were like supposed to be the cat's whiskers because we had completed a core banking migration of 120 branches in 10 months, and we really thought no end of ourselves. And then we went to our CEO, and it was the day after the migration. We went to the CEO, and he said, okay, this good job done. So what else are we going to do next? So it was like I was not going to have a single day's rest because I was thinking I'd done something great, but that's the whole thing. When you are in a startup kind of environment, when you know you're catching up from the behind, when you know there are people who have all the base that they need and you have to catch up with them, complacence tends to become a bad word. And that's how it has been for 5 years. We've just been knocking off items after item, and we really don't have a single day, non-exciting day. That's what it is. You have to take a leap of faith. So when we started as a group, the standard retail banking, corporate banking, all of that was there. But our MD decided to take a leap of faith in the FI segment, financial inclusion segment, and we decided that that's not going to be our strategy for compliance, right? So everybody has a priority sector lending requirement, so everybody does financial inclusion just to get the numbers. We chose to make it a business line. Today it's one of our most strong business lines. And that was a leap of faith we took, and we stuck to it. Irrespective of what other people said, we stuck to it. And it yielded us results because then suddenly we were seeing a completely different kind of a business opportunity which a lot of people did not see at that particular point of time. Partnerships are good, collaborations are better. If you speak to people in the Bangalore sector, you will hear that RBL collaborates best. We even get a little emotional and start getting attached to the problems that our partners have. We get that far. But in most of our relationships that we have with our partners, it's been very collaborative. And we literally every day, our partners come and tell us, this is the problem I want to solve on the ground. And we sit and design a solution which is joined together. We do not think that he's taking away a portion of our business. Should I be competing with him? Should I be not doing this? We have no emotion in that direction, you know. We just decide that, fine, he has a problem to solve. He's likely to do it faster because he has the connect. He's there in the market. So we sit and design the banking solution at the background because we know that regulatorily he is not going to be up there. He won't know the right decisions to do from a compliance perspective, and we build solutions with them. So, and it has yielded us results. So, for instance, under the India Startup Club structure, we have 320 clients who are working with us, and it has been built in a year and a half. And we have such relationships going far back as well, right? As Rakhi said, there is nothing like a strong network that you own. Your first few steps after you become a startup is going to come out of the relationships that you carry with you. Building networks, I don't think there is any choice. Anybody who is in a build-out phase, who is going to start off, who wants to do something anew, has no choice but to build networks. And I would sincerely recommend, I personally have seen us coming out with things at the last moment, just because we had a network relationship who felt that, no, we want this bank to succeed. It is that kind of kind word that Gaurav said. These are networks that you need to build, right? And lastly, monetizing is important. We've seen the wallet industry. We've seen people burning money. We've sat there and wondered, should we be jumping the bandwagon and entering the wallet industry? But at the bottom of it, we always remembered that we will not do something that is not monetized. At the end of it, we are all in business. And these are the few ethos that has kept us going. That is what got us to the IPO. We had a stellar IPO just because we followed these principles relentlessly and with rigor and with discipline. So there was nobody in the bank who would ever leave any of these points aside when they were thinking about business. So this is what I could say is a summary of what RBL Bank is. And yeah, just as a last word, all the best to all of you. And please do reach out to us because we do a good job at the India Startup Club.